It costs money. I also want to introduce Father Edward Beck. He's a Roman Catholic priest. He's also the faith and religion correspondent for CBS News and the author of Soul Provider, Spiritual Steps to Limitless Love.
Anderson Cooper Show. Anderson Cooper, CIA, by the way. But this Father Beck, faith and religious supervisor, whatever, for CBS News. What is a Roman Catholic priest doing with television? Being a correspondent there? The news media is pro-Catholic, always has been. You look at a lot of the shows and things like this, and Sister Act with Whoopi Goldberg, she's a nun and doing nice things, and everybody loves her. MASH TV show with Father Mulcahy, the Roman Catholic priest. He's there as the what do you call him? In the middle, chaplain, the chaplain service. You know, Catholics are always painted as the good people on television. Why? Because they're in control of it. We saw earlier that The Exorcist was written by a Jesuit. Here we see CBS News has a Catholic sitting on the staff. Let's continue.
Father Beck, thanks for being with us. You've joined us here. What do you make of this discussion? Because I don't want this to come off as attacking anybody's religious beliefs, but what do you make of what you've been hearing?
Well, you know, it's problematic for me. It would not be the approach of the Catholic Church toward exorcism. This seems to almost make it a sideshow or becomes like a circus. I think the Catholic Church has recognized exorcism because we admit that the power of evil in somebody and in the world is indeed a powerful thing, and people can be overcome by that. So the power of prayer in somebody's life to help them deal with what may be psychological illness or abuse, very often, you know, what we're talking about here as exorcism, it's people been abused. You know, they have a psychological illness or a medical illness.
Real quick, it's like this stuff, the truth is just hidden right in front of your face. Bob Larson's dressed like a Catholic priest. This other Catholic priest is dressed the same way, but he has a blue sweater on, so they're different. They're dressed the same, but they're not both Catholics. One's a Pentecostal, the other's Roman Catholic. Let's continue.
Something like exorcism in the Catholic Church is rare. I have never witnessed one. I've never talked to anyone who's had one.
There's not one being done every day. Reverend Larson says he's doing more than one a day sometimes.
I can't imagine that. How that could even be. Those in the Catholic Church who will talk about exorcism will say it can sometimes take 2 weeks. 3 weeks, 4 weeks, but that's praying with somebody.
Reverend Larson, isn't it very easy to just say, well, you know, I'm doing this because I've got a demon and I'm going to get that demon out of me and then I'll be cured? I mean, people have long-lasting issues and problems that are leading them to addictive behavior or other issues. Just saying it's a demon, isn't that kind of an easy out?
We're not saying that. But if there's an evil introject that's inhibiting their ability to get help, they need to get the demon out so that, for example, counseling and therapy can assist them.
Father Beck, what do you think about... Sorry, I'm over here. Father Beck,
you move around.
We look freakishly alike. It's like looking at...
I know.
It's a little strange here, I got to say.
I have been called Father Anderson.
I know, you're right.
So you know.
It's like the path not taken for me right there.
Or vice versa.
Right, exactly. Yeah, this could have been you.
I just had to leave that part in there because, again, this is all these people that are in collusion, be the CIA, the Jesuits, the Catholic, you know, priests and stuff like this. They play good cop, bad cop. They play, you know, well, I agree, I disagree, and well, I, you know, they it's a game for these people, okay? And I just find it kind of ironic that they're like, oh, this is, you know, I could have been a Catholic priest and you could have been the TV show host and stuff. It's the same thing. In the high up levels, it's the same thing. They're both working towards the same goals, the same aim. And by the way, Anderson Cooper is a sodomite. You know, so he is a celibate sodomite, like a Catholic priest. Interesting, but let's continue.
When you see these young girls who, I mean, I have no doubt are you know, good people and believe in what they're doing and want to do good in the world, what do you think when you see a 17-year-old performing an exorcism?
They seem like great girls. They're beautiful girls. They seem to have great spirits. However, to get involved in something like this, this young, where you're dealing with the underside of life, the evil, the pain in people's lives, you're not spiritually mature yet. You're not psychologically, physically mature yet.
I want to bring in Dr. Andrew Newberg, who's sitting in the audience. You're a medical doctor. Will you stand up?
Sure.
You're a medical doctor.
Yes.
When you see those exorcism images, what do you think is going on?
When we have done some studies of people who are engaged in these kinds of practices and have these incredible experiences, there are all kinds of changes that are going on inside of the person's brain and inside their body, which can make them think things, feel things, hear things that may or may not be real. So I think people really need to be very fully evaluated by somebody who is a professional who can really say something about whether this person is healthy or not and whether this person has a treatable disease or not before they go and engage in something like this.
Okay, let me just pause it again. Again, part of the whole system, psychiatry, the medical establishment. Oh, we need to be, you know, go to a professional and things like this. Doctors aren't professionals. Okay, they routinely kill people. Malpractice is a very common thing, you know. And again, pharmakia in the Bible is the word, the Greek word for witchcraft, pharmacopoeia, the whole pharmaceutical thing. It's drugs. It's witchcraft. So, you know, it's just funny. It's all these lost people, and they're arguing and debating amongst themselves. Who wants the most power? Who, you know, I'm the one that has the authority. Crazy. But let's continue.
Reverend Larson?
Our opinion is not so far afield, even though others would suggest that. There are people in the therapeutic community who send people to us for help. We, with the Lord's help, get rid of the demons, and then send them back to the psychiatrist and the therapist, and they're able then to go forward with additional healing work.
I question how many people in the therapeutic community really send people to you.
You can question it, but it happens all the time.
Girls, I mean...
Okay, and you will see that with some of this Christian, quote-unquote, Christian deliverance ministry type of stuff. They will actually do this thing where they will say, well, we do, you know, cast devils out of people and things, but then we do recommend psychiatry and they go for counseling and things like this. Very, very, very dangerous, this whole system. I did a whole study on psychiatry. It's a circus without a tent, okay? It's ridiculous. You look at the people who founded it, Sigmund Freud, Carl Jung, all these guys, they're occultists, they're Satanists. Okay, they're messed up in the head themselves. Most of the people that get into psychiatry have depression problems and other mental illness, real, true mental illness type of stuff. You know? So, let's continue. Here's the next one. Okay, I need to actually give a little bit of an introduction into this one because you're going to watch and go, what in the world if I don't introduce it? This is a guy, Kevin Annette, I think his name is, and he was a Catholic priest and... some kind of branch of Catholicism or whatever. But he was up in British Columbia and he became aware of the Roman Catholic Holocaust of some of the Native American people up there. And, you know, he came out and he's like trying to defend them and he got, you know, kicked out of the Catholic system. Now he's like rabidly anti-Catholic. But the guy's like a total witch. He's totally into witchcraft. Not a saved man at all. And watch what he does here and listen to what he's saying. Okay. Again, He is performing an exorcism here. This was in one of the news stories with him, Kevin Annette, and Bob Larson. Okay, check this out.
Death, angels and spirits of heaven and earth, witness and be present now. Christ is risen and conquered death and the Father of lives. Amen. We call upon the angel of the Empire of Christendom and of the Spirit of the Roman Catholic Church and of the City of Rome to listen and respond to these commands which come from the heart of God. We see you and we name you for what you are, a false and murderous church. We have named and unmasked you, we disarm and expel you from this world. Angel and soul of the Empire of Christendom and of the Roman Catholic Church, your time is over and your rule has ended. Death embraces you now. We command you to release your power in this world and depart forevermore.
Wow, that's something. Here all this time I thought it was the Lord in Revelation chapter 17 and 18 that identifies who Mystery Babylon is, the Roman Catholic Church, and he destroys it. No, apparently not. Knucklehead here is like, you know, this New Age witch is like, you know, he's commanding him. He's got a prayer. He's reading that thing. You're going to see him here in a little bit. He shakes some holy water. The Catholic Church is finished after this. I mean, yeah, they're still around, and yes, they're still just as powerful as they've always been, but... it's going to happen. Let's continue.
angel of the Roman Catholic Church, your crimes and your lies have reached the heavens. For the blood of the innocent you have murdered have affronted the heart of God. The children you rape and kill witness against you. You can no longer escape justice. But whatever you do to the least of God's children, you do to God himself and herself.
Did you hear that? Whatever you do to God, you do to himself and herself. Okay, he's a witch. I'm not joking, okay? He believes in the god and goddess. Witchcraft. And you know, Roman Catholicism is evil. Roman Catholicism is wicked. They were guilty of some very heinous crimes. But you can't get Satan to fight against Satan. Doesn't work. Let's continue. This is more for entertainment than anything, just to show you the kind of nutty nonsense that goes on in some of the exorcism circles.
For all your unspeakable crimes, for the lands you have stolen and the souls you have corrupted and the children you have murdered, there can be no cure, for you are a murderous body, born of the evil one and pledged to his purpose of conquest and death, of lies and corruption. Know this truth and accept your death as we shun and turn away from you. In the name of the living Christ and his people, we command the evil one to depart from this place and be banished forever. To the Antichrist, to the one who possesses the minds and hearts of those within this false church, we say, be gone forever, and may the last be first and the first last. In the name of God and all humanity, we command the spirit of Antichrist to release its control over this place. We declare to you, your power is gone. You are disarmed and withered. May your tongue be confused and your arms and authority dissolve, for no longer will your lies be believed. In the name of the goddess of creation and her consort, Jesus the Christ, we declare the power of lies and murder to be gone forever from this false church. We proclaim the presence of the church in this world to be destroyed, now and forevermore. Amen. For God has brought down the mighty from their thrones and lifted up the poor. God has confounded the rich and the powerful and brought justice to the oppressed, so that all mankind may see God as one. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness is not overcome it. It is accomplished. Amen. And so with the remains of these ones you have murdered, we commend the false church of Christendom to God's keeping, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, and dust to dust. The false church is gone, never to rise again. Amen. We proclaim this in the name of the true Christ, God, our mother and father, and of all humanity, who rules now and forevermore. Amen. May all people hear and accept this truth and live in its light forever as free and sovereign souls in a world cleansed of war, of violence, lies, murder, and corruption. In God's name, make it so. Amen.
Now that's how exorcism is done, buddy. I'll tell you what. You say, what's that guy? Oh, Matthew chapter 7. Depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire. I never knew you. Get out of here. But didn't I cast out devils in your name? No. The church is now done. It's now complete. It's finished. It's over. We've destroyed your power here. So let me sprinkle some ashes and throw a little bit of water around. And there, your Catholic church is no more. It's done years ago. You know. No scripture for this junk, people. But let's continue here. Trying to see which one I want to do next. All right. This one's interesting here. I'm just looking at different ones. Let me do this one here. This guy, I'll play this and then I'm going to show you his, where do I have his book? No, not over there. I'll play this and I'll show you the book. Check this out.
I survived two consecutive unrelated haunted houses. I have to give all the credit, and number one to God, but to the Bob Larson's ministry, because it was what I learned through that ministry that I was able to apply to these terrible situations I found myself in.
Given my...
Okay, what you have there is a guy named Patrick Meakin. Okay, right here is one of his books. All right. Was made aware of this, and this guy here had Amish, actually. He lived in Amish country, Holmes County, and he had Amish putting curses on him, and that's true. We'll be talking more about that in the future. But he had problems with spiritual oppression. And it struck me as I'm reading through this book, and it's like the guy's going to modern charismaniac worship. He's watching television. He's got this going on and that going on. And I'm going, this guy's got all kinds of doorways open for devils to attack him. But, you know, all kinds of problems with this. I don't know if I'm going to do a book review on this or not. But the fact he went to Bob Larson, I mean, that should say a few things right there. You know, Bob Larson is a fake. He is a fraud. All right, so, like I said, I might be doing more on that in the future. We'll see. But I'm going to show you this thing here of Bob Larson. Very interesting. Very interesting what happens with this Bob Larson guy. Again, Brother Bryan, I appreciate his work, but he's just so paranoid. He's so paranoid. He thinks the Catholic Church is behind everything and everybody's a covert Jesuit and stuff like this. First of all, that's not true. I don't think everybody is, but here's another case. I'm dealing with facts, people. I'm dealing with documentation. I'm going to show you the truth about Bob Larson. Check this out.
Like Father Amorth, Protestant Reverend Bob Larson's pilgrimage is to rid the world of evil, and that means the devil. His fundamental Pentecostal approach to religion has its critics, but Larson is never short of work. To date, he has performed more than 6,000 exorcisms around the world. His teams of like-minded people exalt the travelling roadshow to do what Jesus did. Historically, exorcism was the prerogative of the Catholic Church and its billion-strong followers.
Historically, exorcism was the business of the Catholic Church. Very true. But check out what happens next.
Pleasure to meet you.
But when hierarchy fought practitioners, exorcism was casus belli. So much so, it led to the religious turf war that exists today between Catholics and Protestants.
We'll get on well anyway because we belong to the same faith. And by the way, this guy here, this older Catholic priest, this is the head of exorcism at the Vatican. And he summoned Bob Larson to come and meet with him. How about that? They're the same faith. Let's continue.
But when Father Amorth and Reverend Larson met in the Christian religious homeland of Rome recently, there was a sense of the pupil meeting the master, complemented by an undoubted mutual respect for each other's work.
This book has cast out many demons.
I demoni, sì. Io uso ancora questo.
He uses this book himself.
I use this book too. Not the same as him, but I quote from this book.
To be with Father Amorth, to receive his blessing, to touch cheeks with him, and to have our hands clasped together. I mean, we're building a bridge, we're crossing a gap, a chasm that for hundreds and hundreds of years has existed. I mean, let's face it, the church some hundred years ago would have burned someone like me at the stake. It wouldn't have been tolerated. But for me to hold a ritual Romanum in my hands, for me to stand in the place where he does what I do, and to realize that what's brought us together is the evil of this age and the understanding we have a common God, a
common Lord, a common enemy, and a common calling. That is so touching to me.
Just pause there for just a minute. That book that he shows, and he says, this book has cast out many devils, you know, or demons, he says. It's an ancient Roman text, the Romana Rhetale or something like that it's called. And the Catholic priest is like, yeah, I use that too. You know, it's crazy. It's insanity. And you say, well, but Bob Larson's a nut. Well, yeah, but he's the foundation for a lot of this deliverance, exorcism type of stuff within Protestant churches, particularly the Pentecostal movement. And the Pentecostal movement, you study the origins of that, this thing's been a cult the whole way through. But now look, here you actually have this priest actually putting his hands upon the heads of Bob Larson and then his wife and putting special blessings upon them. And you mean to tell me that he's not a Catholic or whatever? Dresses like one. Uses the same things, does the same stuff as a Catholic, but he's not a Catholic. Yeah. Watch this.
Father Amorth and Reverend Larson are two devil hunters from opposing religions who have set aside their differences to help those in search of redemption and salvation from the devil inside. To find a cure for problems traditional medicine and psychotherapy hasn't been able to remedy.
Sure, yeah. And I find it interesting, too, that this woman, this Bob Larson's wife, she actually divorced him after this whole thing. Kind of interesting. So, you got to watch out for this papal blessing stuff. I would not let any pope or priest or anybody put a blessing on me. It's a cursing, is what these people are doing. But let's watch the next part here. More interesting stuff.
Could religion be moving into the 21st century? After all, it would have been unthinkable only a few years ago that a senior Catholic priest would side with a Pentecostal Protestant. Just 15 years ago, there were only 20 Catholic Church-appointed exorcists in Rome. Now there are more than 300. The Catholic Church is even training a new batch of exorcists at the prestigious Regina Apostolorum University in Rome.
Si fanno in queste scuole, si fanno lezioni teoriche e pratiche sugli esorcismi. Quindi si parte dai testi biblici che riguardano gli esorcismi. Gli esorcismi operati da Gesù Cristo.
Exorcism performed by Jesus Christ, but the Jesuit priest earlier said Jesus never performed an exorcism. A little confusing. The church is always in agreement, and there, yeah, it's the solid, you know, teachings of the church. Yeah. But I'm going to give you my theory here. I believe that this training of exorcists and things is specifically they're training Pentecostals to do these exorcisms, and in fact, in reality, they're getting, number one, they're getting people possessed with devils. They're putting them in. It's impartations. We're going to see examples of this in the next video clip coming up after this one's done. Number two, they're getting a new brand of inquisitors ready, because a lot of the Pentecostals hate Bible-believing Christians. Modern professing Christians can't stand Bible believers. But let's continue.
E poi i vari formulari che si sono via via formati durante la storia della Chiesa, i formulari per cacciare esorcisti.
Reverend Larson's approach is to filter the world with like-minded people to carry on his work.
Penso che sarà la Chiesa a continuare questo lavoro.
I think it is necessary. What did he say there? It's going to be the church that carries on this work. Yeah, I think he's absolutely right. But they're doing it through the Pentecostal system. which we'll see here in just a couple of minutes, how modern and hip and cool it is. I'm going to show you a very recent video from this year. Let's continue.
Perché è un lavoro utile, è un lavoro anzi direi necessario, per cui penso che saranno gli uomini di chiesa a continuarlo. Da notare che in tutti i secoli del passato non c'erano mai state scuole per esorcisti, però l'esorcista veniva aiutato da altri sacerdoti che si prendevano così, facevano pratica, e quando l'esorcista o per età o per malattia non poteva più fare esorcismi, c'erano già i sacerdoti preparati a fare gli esorcismi. Perché la vera scuola dell'esorcismo è assistere ad esorcismi.
Whoa, boy. So in other words, there's going to be laymen, people that are not necessarily priests. That's what I'm taking from this whole thing here. And I'm going to show you the proof of that. In a movement called the Last Reformation. The Pentecostals are taking this thing to a whole new level. You see, how was the Catholic Church able to get away with such devilment over the centuries? Because of one thing. They took this book away from the people. Now, you can't take the King James Bible physically away from people anymore, but you can take it away from them spiritually by replacing it with a whole bunch of others that are counterfeit. Other Bibles that have Antichrist spirits in them, so that the Holy Spirit doesn't bear witness to this King James Bible, like it does with the King James Bible, say it that way. So you can create a new Dark Ages, just like the Bible said would happen. There will come a famine in the land, not a thirst for water, of eating of bread, but of hearing the words of the Lord. And that back in Amos it says it. Let me find the scripture here. I'm trying to quote from memory. I don't have it memorized, but I'll find it for you here. But the fact of the matter is, there is actually this extreme famine in the land created by Roman Catholicism through the use of their new versions. And these new versions have actually caused people to become ignorant of the scriptures, which is contrary to what they say. Because people say, well, no, the new versions will help us to understand the Bible better. And yet they do the exact opposite. And now you get people going to these Babel buildings, and they don't even carry Bibles anymore. Amos chapter 8, verse 11 and 12. Here's the scriptures I was talking about. Behold, the days come, saith the Lord God, that I will send a famine in the land, not a famine of bread, nor a thirst for water, but of hearing the words of the Lord. Notice it's God that sends it. Why? Because they receive not the love of the truth. If you want to live in sin, if you want to do evil and try to blame it on devils or something, you know, when you get caught, it's not me, it's not me. I'm not the one. You know, my therapist said so. I'm innocent. Then God will actually send you a famine. Verse 12, and they shall wander from sea to sea and from the north even to the east. They shall run to and fro to seek the word of the Lord and shall not find it. How many truly King James Bible believing videos are on the internet? Very few compared to the others. Very few. There are very few ministries that I can even recommend. So many of them have been turned out to be fraudulent. And probably Jesuit, unfortunately. It's a bad situation. It's a very bad situation. But I'm going to show you that this last Reformation thing, I could do a whole series of studies on these crazy nuts, especially the guy that founded it. I mean, the guy that founded it is just, I believe, devil-possessed to the toenails. I mean, this guy is a very wicked man. And they're doing things, and I'll just tell you, to spoil the surprise here, if you will, a little bit. They are baptizing people, and when they're done baptizing them, they cast out devils after the baptism. And you'll see this extreme trauma-based mind control that they're doing to these people. They have their faces this far from the water, and they're screaming at them, go! And they're like doing this tongues thing, and they're screaming at them, go devil, go devil, go! And they're screaming, and the people are like freaking out and scared. This is extreme stuff, okay? Again, if you have small children, this might not be appropriate for them. These are Pentecostal papists. Okay? Let's watch this.
The demonic world is so real. It's very real. I'd seen glimpses of it in churches when evangelists had come or so-called men of God had come. People who walk in authority, they pray for people and see them manifest. But I'd never seen it happen from my own hand. The first real experience I had, and probably the biggest experience I've had, is when my wife and I baptized someone for the first time in our home. And this person, she was involved in a lot of New Age, Reiki healing, tarot card reading, crystals, a lot of things New Age. And we baptized her. And if we had just left it at that, like a normal church service, we would have smiled, given her a certificate, and had a cup of coffee afterwards. But we continued to pray for her and pray for her, and after about 2 minutes, the demons started to manifest. And one after one, they manifest, and we cast them out. And it was the most real, the most radical experience that I've ever had. It opened my eyes up to the battle. This is a fight. We are not just asked. We are not told it's a good idea, but we're commanded by Jesus to cast out demons. We're given the responsibility to set people free in Jesus' name.
Okay, we're commanded. Okay, well, first of all, when Jesus told the disciples to go out and in my name cast out devils and things, he's talking about signs given there for the Jews. That's early on in the book of Acts. The Jews as a nation rejected Jesus Christ. Those sign gifts went away, right? They're not there. Again, that's a whole other big thing, a big point of argument that these wingnuts will do this thing. And again, it's very easy to disprove that because you just simply say, okay, laying hands on the sick and they recover. Let's go see the Pentecostals do that at a local hospital. They won't do it to save their lives. Of course not. They'll fake the ones that they'll try to do the ones that they can fake. All right. But notice here, she was involved in New Age and all this other stuff, and we baptized her and then we cast the devils out of her. Where's that in Scripture? Where are people baptized and then devils are cast out? There's no place in Scripture where this occurs. None. Again, oh, well, yeah, but we're supposed to do this as Christians. We're commanded to do this. Okay, show me some Pauline epistles that say this. Acts is a transition book. The Jews as a nation have not yet rejected Jesus as their Messiah. They're still given another chance. They rejected him, had him crucified, but now they're given another chance. So the sign gifts are there. The Jews require a sign. It's right there. But you see, again, what's going on here? Oh, she was involved in all this New Age stuff, so we had to cast these devils out. Is that what happened in Acts chapter 19? No, they brought their New Age stuff and burned it. And God's Word was glorified. Not, oh, well, we're doing practices that appear nowhere in Scripture. But now let's watch some of this trauma-based mind control. And this is exactly what it is. I'm not being sarcastic. This is exactly what it is. They are doing this. They're humiliating these people in front of a whole crowd. Watch the video coming up. This guy is the head of this Last Reformation thing. This guy's a wing nut. Okay? Tell him I said so. And they're doing this in front of all these people. So it's embarrassing the person that this is happening to. They don't know what's going on. And they're saying, no, no, please don't. And the guy's yelling at her. You go down, go down, go down, go down, go down. You do this, do this, do this, do this. It's horrifying. This takes a strong stomach, okay? And I'm not joking. Here we go.
Why is that fight going on? Because Satan don't like it. But now we are going underwater, and then she's going to come up, and you're going to see a freedom. You're going to see a freedom and a new life. Look at, just kneel down. Don't be afraid. Lay down. Just kneel down. There's freedom. No, you can. You can. You can. You can. You can, in the name of Jesus, you can. You can. It's a new life. But Satan is a liar. Satan is a liar. He has been lying. He has been lying. And he don't want you to give everything over to Jesus Christ. Because when you give you over, he's going to set you free. And Satan's going to lose, and he don't want this.
It's free. It's in you. Yeah, it's coming up.
You can.
My knees don't want to bend.
No. Go down in the name of Jesus.
All right. Jesus didn't say
and she wants to, she can, her knees don't want to bend. She cannot get out. There is a fight going on. But in the name of Jesus, God, we thank you. Just go down. In the name of Jesus, just go down. Down, down. Just go down in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, go down. Go down, go down, go down. In the name of Jesus, go down. Are you ready? Are you ready to get baptized to Jesus Christ? So on your own faith, we baptize you to Jesus Christ. Just go down. Die with Christ, up with Christ.
Okay, stop for a minute. Down with Christ, up with Christ. Where's this at in Scripture? Where? Where's anybody fighting and saying, I don't want to go, I don't want to do it. You're going down. You're going to be baptized. You got to be... Where's this at? Now watch. He does a speaking in tongues thing, and it's probably devils, so, you know, here we go. You're going to see real devils manifesting. Here it is.
Freedom, freedom, freedom. Say the code. Leave her, leave her, leave her right now. Come out, come out, come out, come out, come out. Leave him, go, go, go.
Come out, go, 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 right now, go right now. Shut that
loose, 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 loose. Go, go. Go in the name of Jesus. I command this religious spirit. Go right now in the name of Jesus. Go. 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 Right now, by that again. Come on. Maybe I ain't got any fear. Go right now in the name of Jesus. Come on. Come on, right now. Come on, right now. Come on, right now. Come on, right now.
Let it go.
I command this demon to go. I command this spirit to go.
Go in the name of Jesus. Go right now in the name of Jesus. Get out right now.
Go, go, go! I command him, leave him right now. Come on! Come out! Come out! Come out! Come out! Come out! Come out! Go, 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 go! Remember, she's like, man, it's been leaving right now, right now, right now, right now. Come on! Get up! 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 Okay, this is very vexing stuff. I'm sorry to even be playing this stuff. It's insanity. This is Satanism. This is not New Testament. Nowhere is this stuff happening in the New Testament. Nowhere is anybody speaking in tongues while somebody's being baptized. Nowhere is anybody casting out devils while somebody's being baptized. This is absurdity. But you see, they've worked so hard in the Pentecostal system to take God's word from the hands of people so that they can get away with this nonsense. Absolute total nonsense. This is not New Testament. This is Roman Catholic exorcism on steroids. Okay? I mean, it's insanity. But notice the mind control of the video. Remember earlier we saw how the Jesuits are involved in movie production? They have their own movie production companies and things. Notice as it's playing the hard boom, 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 boom in the background. Faster than your normal heart rate. That's centuries-old technique to get the adrenaline going. That's why they beat drums before they go into war. This is mind control, folks. Again, I'm playing this so that you can spot it and observe this and go, wait a second, whoa, this stuff is wrong. Now watch the occultism that they do coming up when they push the people under the water and watch. Watch the occult symbolism of somebody underwater and it's in slow motion and it's dark all around and there's a bright light shining under the water. This is Satanism, is what this is. They're putting devils into people. This is impartation. This is not exorcism. Impartation. They're putting devils into people, and the people praise Jesus after the devils are put into them. Exactly like happens in the New Testament. The man with legion, he comes and he praises Jesus. People that have devils in them, they come, they fall down, they praise Jesus. That's what this thing is. Okay? But watch the occultism when the guys go under the water. And now watch what the one guy does. He goes under the water and he goes like this. He puts his body into the shape of a cross, prostrating himself. Roman Catholic practice. That is a Jesuit practice. I'm not joking. Initiated Jesuits, they will prostrate themselves on the floor, put their body in the form of a cross.
Check this out. Watch. Okay, notice they stop and they don't go. Baptism is you take, every time I've ever seen it, you go back like this and up. I would baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost. You're under the water and you come back up, symbolizing the death, burial, resurrection of Jesus Christ. Death, burial, and resurrection of yourself and coming up as a new man. Okay? That's what I've, always seen with Christians. Not this stuff here. But notice they push him under the water and the people are just like floating under the water, this dramatic, like, floating slow motion thing. That's not baptism that they're showing, because baptism, you go down, you come back up. What are they trying to show? These people are Satanists. Now watch the reaction. Watch the like they're on drugs. They're filled with devils.
Whoa. Hallelujah. Do you experience the freedom? You're free.
Amen.
Yeah! Come on! Yeah! God, stand up. How is it?
Thank you! Thank you! Fill it right now. Holy Spirit, come on. Rabba, shut down.
Come on, a new life. Come on, I can't see it. I love it. Yes.
Pause there for a minute again. Don't they sound like Catholic monks? Monks. Catholic monks? Like a chant. Let's continue.
Come on, friends, can you see it? This is the power in baptism. Repent from your sins toward Jesus Christ. It's a battle, but Satan have lost. Jesus is alive.
A new life.
Thank you that you're feeling well. Thank you. Amen. Amen.
Oh, you got those. Freedom. He had never been speaking tongues before now.
Ah, powerful!
We have seen so many people got delivered from sin in baptism. We have seen schizophrenic people get delivered from demons in baptism. We have seen people with eating disorder get delivered in baptism. We have seen sick people get healed in baptism. We have seen many people who was not able before to receive the baptism with the Holy Spirit. But when they got baptized in water, the Holy Spirit came over them and they started to speak in tongues.
It is real. I tell you, it's real. I don't know how to explain it, but the Spirit of God came and I was really baptized in the Spirit. I really spoke in tongues.
Okay, yeah, the creepo factor is kind of pegged right now, It's real. It's real. I felt it. I was speaking in tongues. Okay. Yeah. So, you ever see this kind of stuff coming to your town? And they're trying to spread this thing around, this last Reformation thing. Big channel on YouTube. Again, this is all recent. This thing came out this year. All right. The Catholic Church, their greatest single desire is to get rid of the Bible. If they can get this book out of your life, they can get by with any kind of devilment. They can get you to believe anything. Like maybe that the cookie and the wine becomes actual flesh and blood, and you can eat flesh and blood even though that's cannibalism, but it's not really flesh and blood, but yet it is. Yeah. The Catholic Church wants to get rid of the King James Bible. That's the whole issue. That's why I dedicate my life to this book and getting this book out, preaching this book and getting you to understand this is your only hope. An understanding of the Holy Word of God. And when you have, brethren, I try to teach you in every area I can. My wife and I both dedicate our lives to the body of Christ, to warning you about all the stuff that we can. But when it comes down to it, all I can really do is just give you this book. And just say, you hold on to this book. And anybody comes along and they start doing something, you say, wait a second. Could you give me a chapter and verse on that? Where's this at in Scripture? That's all you really need, brethren. We'll do our best to try and educate you and inform you, but the devil is extremely active. I get so frustrated because there's just so many things that I see coming out that are satanic, that are the devil, the Jesuits, the Catholics, whoever are behind it, and I'm just going, I can't possibly cover this all. I do my best to cover as much as I can, but it comes down to the book, the Bible. This is the book that they fear. This is the book that they've brought out over 200 new versions since 1881, trying to get rid of this book. They don't like this book. You better hang on to this book. Be right back. All right, we're going to conclude the study with how to do real spiritual warfare. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 10. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. Verses 3 through 5, because you will run into devil-possessed people. You will have oppression from devils. You will have things that there will be going to be times. I mean, I get a lot of letters from people, a lot of emails and private messages and whatever else. And I get people in there saying, like, man, it's really weird. The other night I'm like laying in bed and I feel like this really evil presence. And I'm going, okay, what is this? I don't know what's going on here. And you start to feel really depressed or feel a really heavy, oppressive, kind of like almost pushing you down kind of a thing. And you go, you know, Lord, please help me. And you start praying and you start to sing hymns. You get your King James Bible out. You start reading and the feelings lift and you go, oh, got through that. There is spiritual warfare, all right? Real spiritual warfare. So let's see about this here. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, beginning in verse 3. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Okay, as a Christian, you are on the most deadly of all battlefields. Why? Because it is a spiritual battlefield. You cannot take a shotgun or a sword or a knife or a baseball bat or whatever and go knock a demon out and kill him or something. Shoot him, you know, doesn't work. It'd be easier if it, you know, could be that way. But the fact is, there could be devils right here behind me, walking back and forth, or coming in between me and the camera here. I don't even know it. All of a sudden I can feel like, whoa, okay, I feel something really weird. There's something real strange. See? But where does the battle start? If you start to get attacks coming against you, spiritual attacks, where does it begin according to our text? In your thoughts. Evil thoughts arising in your minds. I can guarantee you, I've been through this thing plenty of times. When you get attacked spiritually, it'll start to come into your mind. I'll give you an example. You'll be doing something and all of a sudden it'll just be like, you're not really saved. And you're like, huh? You know that God's not real. There is no God. You understand that, don't you? You're putting on a pageant. This whole thing's fake. You know it's fake. When are you going to come into reality? And you start going, but these thoughts, these doubts will start to arise, and you'll go, wait a second here. What's happening? You're under spiritual attack. And you go, wait a second. Whoa, hold on a second here. Shut up there, whatever is putting this into my mind. I know that the Bible is true. It accurately predicts things thousands of years before they happen. Where did the earth come from? If there's no God, I mean, come on, please give me a break. Okay, whoever's, you know, whatever's trying to deceive me, run on. You aren't going to get me. Okay? Here's another one, especially if you're married. You're doing things and stuff, and all of a sudden it's just like, you know, your wife's no good. Huh? She doesn't work nearly as hard as other women. I mean, she's probably cheating on you behind your back. Why would you trust a woman like that? You know, it'd be a lot better if she was gone. You know, there's that good-looking girl that works down at the hardware store or down at the grocery store. You could probably get her on a date and things like this. And you really, and you go, what, hold on there. What happens? Casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God. And your marriage, you know, is something that God gave you knowledge to do, and you should keep in mind that as a man, you're the spiritual protector of your wife and your children as well. You have spiritual headship in the home, so guess whose thoughts are going to be attacked first in that marriage? Yeah. Oh, yeah. And you ladies out there, too, that have good saved husbands, you're going to get it, too. That husband of yours, you know, he's not very good. He could work a whole lot harder, you know. I mean, he kind of is, you know, has some of the manners. You know, he's not a very good man. Mm-hmm. He'll start working. The devils will start to work on your mind. I don't believe you can be possessed, but I certainly believe in oppression. And you know what is going to happen? Or when it will happen, I should say, it that way? It'll happen a lot of times when you're messing around with something. I've seen that too. You know, you get onto YouTube and you're just like, I want to do something for the Lord. I should be witnessing, or I, you know, have that sermon I wanted to watch or whatever else. And all of a sudden you start to get kind of pulled away into the worldly stuff. And you start to look at racing, vehicle racing or gun shooting. Or, I'm talking as a man here. Women, I don't know what your thing is. But you start to get into that stuff and you start to go off, you know, and you say, and I got to kick another thing here. You say, well, brother so-and-so watches this stuff. I know that brother so-and-so. But that might not be how the Lord's dealing with you. See, there might be other brethren out there that the Lord will let them get away with certain things because their life situation is different, right? And I'm talking innocent stuff, okay? I'm not even talking, if you're looking at pornography or watching satanic stuff or whatever, well, you have no excuse, okay? Not at all. But if the Lord's told you to do something with your life and you're not doing it, you are opening up a doorway whereby the devil can attack you. You're giving place to the devil. And it's not some spirit that comes in and you have to have the spirit cast out of you or something. Uh-uh. It's your fault, your problem. You confess your deeds, as we read earlier in the beginning of the study back in the book of Acts. All right? Very important there. You have to guard your thoughts. You have to guard your mind. And it's ironic because what is the best way to guard your head? The helmet of salvation. We're going to read about that here in just a little bit. Very interesting. But let's go here to Galatians chapter 5 in verse 16. And again, keep this stuff in mind when we're talking about devil oppression, possession, exorcism, deliverance, all this other stuff. Let's look and see here what's going on in this passage. If devils are mentioned, that something that a Christian is struggling with, I was at some place and the devils entered into me. You know. Let's look about this. Galatians chapter 5, verse 16. This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. But if ye be led of the Spirit, ye are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh. It doesn't say the different types of devils. Okay? You have the devil of adultery and of fornication and of uncleanness and the devil of lasciviousness. No, it says the works of the flesh are manifest. Which are these? Do you ever hear somebody say there's devils that manifest themselves in so-and-so? I don't mean that's there for lost people. But for saved people, when you have things manifesting, it's the works of your flesh. And Galatians chapter 5, verses 19 through 21 is a real good self-examination. You know, you go through this and you go, okay, am I guilty of adultery? I don't think so. What about fornication? What about uncleanness, lasciviousness? Go down through the list. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, and drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Now the kingdom of God has two different meanings in the Bible. Number one, you have the kingdom of God as a reference to the millennial kingdom that's coming, also called the kingdom of heaven. Okay? The kingdom of heaven always refers to the physical millennial kingdom. The kingdom of God can refer to that, but also refers to spiritual fellowship between you and God. Okay, you can read about that in the book of Romans, the kingdom of God. All right there. It's fellowship. So if you're a Christian, and these verses, verses 19 through 21, are written to Christians. You say, witchcraft? Huh? Witchcraft? Yeah, witchcraft. Possible for a Christian. And what you can do, hearing the noise downstairs. I'll be back. I gotta check this out real quickly here. Be right back. All right, sorry about that. Heard a weird vibrating noise, and I noticed my lights are flickering. And I'm thinking, okay, what's going on here? Wife using her printer, it's hooked up to the same outlet as this wall here. So, wonderful wiring in this place, I'm sure. But let's continue with what we were saying here. The fact is, when you start to mess around with your flesh, you are the one who's bringing evil into your own life. So that oppression that can happen to a Christian is the result of that Christian living in sin. Not because there's some devils that have gotten a hold of you and possessed you and now you need to have them cast out or something. That's ridiculous. Well, let's continue here. Galatians chapter 5, verse 22. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ's have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us not be desirous of vainglory, provoking one another, envying one another. If you are a Christian, part of your life your life actually, is going to be about sanctification. It's going to be about the Lord saying, hey, let's clean up that house of yours, your spiritual house, so to speak. And the Lord's going to come along and he's going to say, okay, that needs to go, that needs to go, that needs to go. And when you rebel, that's when the lusts of the flesh start to come in. And you say, well, I don't really want to give up this or I don't want to give up that. Those lusts will come in and you'll start to mess up. That's why you will not have the fruit of the Spirit. You will not manifest the fruit of the Spirit when you are walking according to the flesh. Again, there's no casting out of devils here because some Christian got influenced by the spirit of witchcraft or something. And so we have to have the thing cast out like we saw in the video clips. It's nonsense. Absolute total nonsense. Finally, let's go to Ephesians chapter 6. The greatest portion of scripture on spiritual warfare. Ephesians chapter 6, beginning in verse 10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Are devils real? Yes, very real. 13, verse 13. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked, and take the helmet of salvation, you know, to guard those thoughts, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Make sure that you're using the right one, not one that comes from the Vatican. Verse 18, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. Pray for others too that are saved. And for me, that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in bonds, that therein I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. And that's the solution. Notice Paul didn't say, make sure that you have a good crucifix to cast out demons. No, he didn't say that. Make sure that you got some holy water to shake at things. I didn't say that. Make sure to take some oil and you know, walk around and do the sign of the cross and oil on everything and stuff like this. And I got to go plead the blood and walk around my property and plead it, make a bloodline or something. This stuff is all foreign to Scripture. It's not foreign to Catholicism, though. So I guess if you're a good Catholic, then you can mess with that stuff. If you're a Bible-believing Christian, you're going to say, no thank you, not interested in your form of witchcraft. I don't think so. And isn't it ironic that one of the lusts of the flesh is witchcraft, capable of being committed by a Christian? If you've been drawn into this whole deliverance ministry thing, let me just say, brother, sister, you need to repent of that. You are involved in a Christian form of witchcraft. Deliverance ministry is witchcraft. All of your little hocus-pocus stuff and pleading the blood, never mentioned in Scripture, holy water, sprinkling holy water on things and anointing things with oil, putting the sign of the cross on people's foreheads and anointing your property and anointing this and anointing that. No. You're doing things that pagan Roman Catholic priests are doing. You're involved in witchcraft. If you have problems in your life, what you need to do is you need to ask the Lord and say, okay, Lord, why am I having these problems? You have Christians and they say, oh, I just have no joy. I have no joy. Well, that's a problem. There's some kind of a problem there. And you need to get that thing fixed up. All right? So that is going to be it for this study. I really need to warn about this stuff. I've really never done a big study on this before. And I thank the Lord that He helped me to get this study done. It's been a lot of research. It took a lot of time to go through all these videos and all this stuff and everything else. But I think that I've proved very well that, with the Lord's help, that exorcism and deliverance ministries are purely 100% being done by lost people and Roman Catholics. If there's a Christian that's tied up in the movement, the Lord's going to draw them out of that, definitely. This charismatic movement stuff is so dangerous, extremely dangerous. And when you are allowing your mouth to be taken over by some kind of a spirit that speaks through you, you got to be real careful with that stuff. So that is going to be it. I thank you for watching, and I pray that you get as far away from this whole deliverance exorcism stuff as you can.